And during the next 3 hours or so, we'll also be giving you a flavour of the television of 1963 with clips and commercials in between these complete programmes. Now straight into our first gem from the archives. This week was ITV's answer to the BBC's current affairs flagship, Panorama, and during its long run, which began in 1956, it was often at the cutting edge of controversial news gathering, although it also had its lighter moments. In 1963, This Week took a look at satire. The great TV satire boom was then at its height, with That Was the Week that was maturing, if that's the word, into not so much a programme, more a way of life. Another of those catchy titles. Of course, it wasn't satire at all in literary terms, but malicious entertainment, and a welcome departure from the rather old-fashioned Reithian radio-style comedy, which is all we had up until then. On the This Week that follows, our man on philosophy, Bryan Magee, did a quick survey of the satire stories so far, ably assisted by the marvellous John Bird, playing a well-known Tory politician.
Reporting. Tonight, This Week takes a look at the new wave of humour which has burst over this country in the last couple of years, the so-called satire movement, which has been responsible for an entirely new kind of television programme, founded a new magazine, produced new sorts of reviews on the London stage, even founded a London nightclub, The Establishment, specially for the lampooning of politicians, television interviewers and other people in the public eye.
Tonight we have with us the chairman of the Conservative Party. Good evening, sir.
What? Good evening.
Good evening. Now, if I can say so, sir, the Conservatives have been going through rather a bad patch lately and have suffered many setbacks at recent by-elections. Now, what is your attitude towards all this, sir?
Well, I would like to say straight away that, in my view, the elections as such are an extremely unreliable means of estimating a government's worth or popularity. I would echo the remarks here of Mr. Peregrine Worsthorne of the Sunday Telegraph, who, as you can tell, speaks for the masses, when he said that these by-election setbacks do show one thing above all, and that is that the government are doing their job and doing it terribly well. And I'd agree wholeheartedly.
Well, would you like to elaborate on this theme, sir?
Not at the moment, no. I would like to say that, you see, it is a question of getting over to the electorate, getting over to them what one is trying to do. And the electorate, of course, are all frightfully nice fellows, of course, all of them frightfully nice fellows. But they are, of course, appallingly stupid, and they don't really understand what it is we're trying to do, and that's the key thing there.
I
you take a specific issue like defence.
Quite.
Now, defence, the nuclear business.
Yes, indeed.
Frightfully complicated, though.
Right.
Terribly complicated.
Right.
And we've done our best, but we did know it was going to be complicated when it came up. And we thought, well, we didn't want to oversimplify anything. So we thought the only honest course is not to tell anybody anything about the whole thing.
Yeah.
And that we did, in a fair degree of success, I think. Do you know anything about it at all?
Not a thing, no.
Not a thing, no. Ludicrously stupid yourself.
Do you think, sir, that it'd be a good idea, sir, after 11 years of the Conservative rule, it'd be a good idea to have a change of government?
Oh, well, we have had a change of government, my dear fellow. I mean, we've gone as far as I think it's prudent to go. One shouldn't take these things too far. We do have a lot of new faces in the cabinet, but we also have a lot of old faces left in the cabinet. For example, both of Mr. Butler's.
Yes, yeah, good to see them back there. Quite. Of course, Mr. Reginald Maudlin took over from Mr. Selwyn Lloyd, and he relinquished his office of colonial secretary to Mr. Duncan Sands, who now combines his office, the one he originally held, that of Commonwealth Relations.
Yes, well, Mr. Maudlin felt it was time he made way for an older and less experienced man, and of course, Sands has always wanted to combine the office of Commonwealth Relations with that of colonial secretary, because he says he can't tell one black man from another anyway.
Yes,
just frightening with all these sort of new nationalist leaders, you know, in the colonies, with their great drums and things dancing around their campfires, uttering their shrill cries. Maboya and Kenyatta and Nairia and Diefenbaker and Menzies.
Yes, it must be difficult to find out.
The establishment nightclub was founded by a young man just down from Cambridge, 23-year-old Peter Cook.
I wanted to start a nightclub, and I wanted to call it The Establishment, and I wanted it to be as it was when it opened, where you could drink, eat, and see a show of this kind. I must take full blame for attaching the ghastly label satirical to it. I put a great sign outside the establishment saying London's first satirical nightclub, because I thought there'd be hundreds, and we'd say we're the first, and still the only one as far as I know. I then issued lots of leaflets saying that we were going to open a satirical nightclub, which, having read the reviews of Beyond the Fringe, I suddenly realised what we were doing. And through this, 10,000 people joined before it opened, so they obviously wanted to have it.
The new wave of this kind of humour really began only 3 years ago, when a review called Beyond the Fringe opened at the Edinburgh Festival of 1960. The whole cast consisted of only four young men, two of them, Alan Bennett and Dudley Muir, just down from Oxford, and the other two, Jonathan Miller and Peter Cook, just down from Cambridge. There was no orchestra, no scenery, no costumes, no dancing girls. The jokes weren't about mothers-in-law or beer or about show business, but about serious things that really matter: politics, class distinctions, adulation of the royal family, the Church of England, and so on. They were personally abusive about individuals. The most famous thing in the review was Peter Cook's long and merciless imitation of Harold Macmillan. Now, 3 years later, Beyond the Fringe is still running in London's West End. But not with the original cast. They took it over to New York and opened on Broadway in the week of the Cuba crisis over a year ago, and it's still running over there. I was there at the first night myself, as a matter of fact. To my surprise, the audience laughed just as much as the audience I'd seen it with in London, even at what you'd think were the very English jokes, for instance, about class.
I think at about this juncture, it'd be wise to point out to those of you who haven't noticed, and God knows it's apparent enough, that Jonathan Miller and myself come from good families and have had the benefits of a public school education, whereas the other two members of the cast have worked their way up from working class origins. And yet Jonathan and I are working together with them in the cast and treating them as equals. And I'd like to say it's proving to be a most enjoyable, worthwhile and stimulating experience for both of us. Wouldn't you agree, Jonathan?
Neil, I'm most impressed by the whole thing.
Well, I suppose we are working class, but I wonder how many of these people have realised that Jonathan Miller's a Jew.
I suppose he gets away with it because of his ginger hair, actually.
I'd rather be working class than be a Jew.
Oh, any day.
But think of the awful situation if you were working class and a Jew.
There's always somebody worse off than yourself.
In fact, I'm not really a Jew, just Jewish, not the whole hog.
The satire movement burst into journalism 2 years ago with the appearance of the fortnightly magazine, Private Eye.
I'm not another Churchill, I'm Napoleon.
Darling, you are wonderful.
Brothers, what are we worrying about?
You, brother.
Of course, Peter Thornycroft told a pack of lies in the house. And this chap Galbraith, he made a bloody idiot of himself. But if all the liars and fools in my government resigned, there wouldn't be any government left.
Private Eye lashed out not only at politicians, but at public figures of all kinds, and sometimes very savagely. When C.P. Snow, the writer, was in danger of losing his sight in an eye operation, they joked about it. Private Eye had its finest hour 18 months ago when Harold Macmillan sacked a third of his cabinet.
Dear Lloyd, we've worked closely together now on many problems for some years, and you know me well enough not to be surprised at my decision to stab you in the back. I have reached this conclusion after studying the present state of the restrictionary policies which I asked you to put into effect last year. Seems to me that one of us must go. I would therefore appreciate your cooperation in carrying the entire can. Yours faithfully, H. Macmillan.
The sort of thing Private Eye was doing seemed very new, but was in fact very old. This kind of abuse was taken for granted by past generations, going back a very long way. In fact, it's really... 20th century that's been exceptional, and all the satire movement's done is to bring us back to normal. The cartoons over 100 years ago of Seymour were just as outrageous as Private Eyes are today. This one by Rowlandson shows a drunk Prince of Wales bursting into the sick room of his father, King George III, with a lot of roistering companions shouting ruderies. Later, when this rowdy prince was King George IV, he was constantly caricatured himself for his spreading obesity and his self-indulgent way of life. Writers were every bit as abusive as cartoonists. 200 years ago, the famous Junius was writing in the Public Advertiser. A typical example of him is this comment on his contemporary Duke of Grafton. It's not that he kept a mistress at home, but that he constantly attended her abroad. It's not the private indulgence, but the public insult of which I complain. Well, that could be Private Eye at almost any time during the Profumo scandal of 1963. A generation or two later, in the reign of King George IV, at the beginning of the last century, Charles Greville was writing, and he made sure, too, that it was published. A more contemptible, cowardly, selfish, unfeeling dog does not exist than this king, on whom such flattery is constantly lavished. Well, it's pretty inconceivable, I think, that anyone would write in this way about Queen Elizabeth II now, even Private Eye. But people went on abusing each other publicly like this well into the reign of Queen Victoria. Politicians did it just as much as journalists. For instance, Disraeli said of another Prime Minister, Lord John Russell, "If a traveller were informed that this man were leader of the House of Commons, he might begin to comprehend that the Egyptians worshipped an insect." Well, even if Sir Alec Douglas Hume and Harold Wilson think like that about each other, I don't think they'd dream of saying it in public, at least in today's atmosphere. And it wasn't even just journalists and politicians who talked like that. The most eminent men of letters did it too. Carlyle refused to receive Swinburne on the grounds that he had no wish to meet somebody who, he said, was sitting in a sewer and adding to it. Swinburne himself could give as good as he got. He let it be publicly known that he'd written to the most eminent living American writer, Emerson, and told him that he was a hoary-headed and toothless baboon who, first lifted into notice on the shoulder of Carlyle, now spits and splutters from a filthier platform of his own finding and fouling. It was only from the very end of Queen Victoria's reign onwards that our way of carrying on public controversy became at first respectable, then stuffy. Personal abuse came to be considered in bad taste, magic phrase. Even Churchill's denunciations of Hitler during the Second World War were pretty weak stuff compared with some of the things I've just been reading. It isn't till these last couple of years when you have, say, Private Eye calling a senior cabinet minister by name a flabby-faced old coward that we're back once more in the mainstream of tradition. But Private Eye, beyond the fringe and the establishment, were successful, but they numbered their audience, nevertheless, only in thousands. It was when satire appeared on television that it broke through to a real mass audience of millions. And this happened in November 1962.
That was the week that was, it's over, let it go. 52 times a year, the week is done and over with before you know. The world and the weather help fashion a week. The lunatic thought politicians will speak. The hindsight that always illumines the press. The sex life of film stars, the general mess. The one week the cabinet gets rearranged. The next week, April, Ashley says, nothing has changed.
For those of you who are still feeling a little downhearted about Britain's diminishing place in the world, let me read you a list of the colonies we've still got.
Satire presented not only a new type of humour, but a new type of humorist. They were nearly all very young, highly educated, mostly at Oxford and Cambridge. Perhaps rather upper middle class, to put it in old-fashioned terms. Most of them had little or no professional experience, and they all seemed to know each other. Private Eye was founded by three young men who'd all been at the same public school together. Their resident cartoonist, William Rushton, also became famous on That Was the Week That Was. The key figure in Beyond the Fringe, Peter Cook, was also the founder of the establishment nightclub, and is now part owner of Private Eye as well, and so on. They're all a very close interconnecting group. The big exception is someone older with years of professional experience behind him and standing outside the English education and class structure altogether, Bernard Braden.
Well, good evening. A few days ago, I read that America's Senator Goldwater feeds his speeches through a computer in case he unwittingly contradicts himself. Boy, if George Brown did that, Britain would have the first computer in orbit. See, too, with the magazine Which specialize in comparing the merits of consumer products and telling its readers which is the best. Well, this week, we learned that they are making an investigation into contraceptives. One of our researchers phoned up to volunteer, but was told that their methods are being kept very secret and that the investigation will cover several months. Because of the delicacy of the subject matter, the investigation will not be printed in the normal publication, but will be printed separately, possibly as a pull-out supplement. We also learned this week that Lord Hume, now officially Sir Alec, but becoming known in some circles as Fireball X Earl 14, keeps his own joke book with stories to match the occasion.
Make 'em laugh, make 'em laugh. Like this lad, be prepared, make 'em laugh. My jokes cause folks to laugh themselves hoarse. There are exceptions, of course. All my quips are so neat, even Rustin can hardly compete. If words come up like Munich, Chamberlain, or repeat, just quickly tell a joke, but should that joke fail to please, then pose for the photographers in garments like these. Make 'em laugh, make 'em laugh, make 'em laugh.
For these regular Saturday night appearances, Bernard Braden has just received the award for Television Personality of the Year. At the same time as he got this at the annual television ball at the Dorchester Hotel a couple of weeks ago, a special award was also made to the producer of That Was the Week That Was. These awards marked the tremendous popular success of satire. When the BBC put on That Was the Week That Was, they hoped for an audience of 2.5 million. They actually got an audience several times that number. The programme became a topic of conversation everywhere. Newspapers and gossip columns were full of the new personalities that suddenly rose to fame. These are just a few of the press cuttings about David Frost alone. Their enormous salaries received tremendous publicity. And one wonders, what if on these young men who suddenly and completely unexpectedly find themselves well off and famous? What difference, for example, has it made to William Rushton?
Yeah, I think a basic difference, obviously, is financial, in that I can now afford trousers and boots. And I've sold my bicycle, but on the other hand, I haven't bought a car. I never like travelling in cars, anyway. I use a few more taxis. So a great luxury. I mean, you very rarely, you usually get a seat in a taxi, you know. I mean, occasionally you find standing room only, it's very rare. And, all right, I still live at home with my dear old mum, evening mother, and, yeah, difference, right?
Don't you find that you're typed as a television figure?
Yes, there is this danger. I mean, rather than my strange expedition in the north, Kinross, you know, I was desperately saying, don't worry, it's nothing to do with That Was the Week, nothing to do with it at all, you know, but they keep on saying, William Rushton, comedy singer, and, TW personality and all the rest of it. It's an ugly thing to have stuck around your neck. There you are. There is this strange business of being recognised in the street, you know, when you're just walking down and everyone goes, ah, that was the week, that was, you know, thank you very much for eating, you know. It does lead to strange adventures. If you're sitting alone in the pub, you know, people do come up and chat, you know, splendid, you know, they wouldn't normally. I mean, we're reserved people.
Not only William Rushton, but everybody who's been made famous by satire seems to claim that really it hasn't made any difference to them at all. Well, it may not have made any difference to them, but it has to some of its victims. And not everybody's happy about this. Libel suits are not the only troubles the satire movement is now facing. The rise of satire was sudden and spectacular. Now, equally suddenly, it seems to be in decline. On Saturday, That Was the Week That Was will appear for the last time. It's being taken off indefinitely and probably for good. The circulation of Private Eye is going down. The establishment nightclub, with roulette playing upstairs, is now merely a shadow of its original intentions. The whole thing seems, as it were, to be falling apart. Why? In New York, where the review that started the whole satire movement, Beyond the Fringe, is still running, this week talked to two members of the original cast, Peter Cook and Jonathan Miller. At least one of these, Jonathan Miller, plans to leave review for good when the show's run comes to an end. I asked him whether he thought the party was over for all of them.
Well, I think that the party perhaps is over. The, as an entity, simply because the press must move on to something new. Because they're parasitic on their own inventions, there comes a certain point where the invention no longer provides the blood that they require. And, in that way, the party is over. But something's been started, some sense of the use of humour in political satire has been established, and in a looser, more diffuse way, I think that this sort of thing will be with us for some while. At least I hope so. I don't think so. No, it's like saying that skating is over. You know, people go on skating. It's not satire. Isn't a thing which just fades away. It's a continuous thing. People suddenly discovered it was there, being there the whole time, as everybody well knew. I think the sort of enormous amount of press coverage and television coverage will fade away, but some people do write satirical things, and that will continue. I don't think it's something like the Beatles.
Well, I think it'll always go on, but probably under some other name. I think one had to realise that the satire boom is over and had to start a new boom doing exactly the same thing, you know, and calling it cabbage. So we had a great cabbage boom, you see.
I asked Michael Frayn, humorous writer for The Guardian and The Observer, and perhaps the most gifted person associated with the whole movement, why, in his opinion, it arose so suddenly only 3 years ago.
Well, it is very difficult to say, but in 1961, when Beyond the Fringe opened in London, we'd had 10 years of stable, steady, conservative government and the middle classes in this country, and quite a large section of the working classes were better off than they'd ever been before. But there were still minorities in this country, and of course majorities abroad, who were still suffering from poverty and still suffering from the most outrageous injustices, which could only be set right by, among other things, the expenditure of large sums of money. And I think people welcomed the opportunity to express their guilt feelings in some way, to show that they were aware that everything wasn't right, in a way that didn't involve any increase in their income tax.
You've sometimes been very critical, haven't you, of Private Eye for what you call the cruelty of their humour. Can you recall the occasions?
Well, there were one or two things they did which I thought were rather unpleasant. The only thing I can remember offhand is the time they made fun of C.P. Snow for having a detached retina in one of his eyes. Now, the point about this was partly that it's cruel and unpleasant to mock people for physical disabilities, but also that it's senseless, because there's nothing Snow can do about his detached retina. There's no action you expect him to take. You're not actually making any coherent criticism of him. You're simply being rude without any constructive intention whatsoever.
Now, why should satirists have done this? What has it got to do with satire?
Well, I think they got pushed into doing it, or doing it more, once they started doing it, because they discovered that people liked it. People like seeing other people humiliated in public. It makes very good entertainment.
But aren't you in fact saying that it's sadistic?
Yes, I think it is. I think possibly there's an element of sadism. There's certainly an element of malice in all satire, good, bad, and indifferent. What attracts people to satire in the first place is seeing people, big people made fools of, and seeing a big idea as they've always respected made to look silly. But if this element of malice is just used for its own sake, just to appeal to people sharp and Freuder, it seems to me insignificant. But if you can use it to attract people to new ideas and to making constructive criticisms of ideas so that action can be taken, then that is justifiable.
You've mentioned sadism. What other major faults do you find in the satire movement?
Well, I think finally it stopped being satire. Finally, when the entertainment industry took it up, it just became a new form of entertainment. It just meant that the entertainment industry abandoned its old conventions of being respectful. and adopted new conventions of being disrespectful.
Why do you think it's suddenly falling apart now in the way it seems to be doing, so soon after it was born?
Well, it became a fashion in the entertainment business, and fashions have to die within a few years. What's in must be out quite shortly afterwards, as surely as night follows day, because that's what it's all about.
Even if the popularity of satire is now in decline, it's got some pretty solid achievements to its credit. It's brought first-class entertainment to millions of people. It set a new standard of outspokenness on television, on the London stage, and in the press, and this, I think, is healthy for all of us. And most important of all, it's broken the taboo on criticising the sacred cows of our establishment, and this, I think, can never be reformed in its old strength. I admit its faults, and in particular, I think that the occasional cruelty is not to be defended. But on balance, we all owe it, I think, a debt of gratitude. I, for one, would like to give, well, if not three cheers, anyway, 2.5 cheers for satire.
Yes, we have done with a fairly great success, I think.
To revert to an earlier point of yours, so that elections as such are out of date.
Ah, no. You anticipate me there. You misquote me there. What I did say was that elections are unreliable. I think this is true. Now, I think we should go in much more, instead of elections, go in much more of a sort of market research.
Really?
Attitude. Yeah. Well, it can get much deeper, much more complex than with this very hit or miss voting method.
Well, how does it work?
Well, I mean, the normal way market research does work. I mean, one sends interviewers out to interview people with key questions, such as, do you want to go on in peace and prosperity with the Conservatives, or are you stupid enough to chance in for another 5 years of socialist botching up, something like that? Take a random area, like South Kensington, and you're there.
Well, thank you very much.
That's all from this week. We'll be back again at the same time next Thursday. Good night.
Cardigan, looking a bit like a young family doctor in a cough mixture commercial.